Yeah, Feli. Have you played much against Feli? I mean, he's just a solid European player. He's always at Insomnia. Okay. I don't know if you've played against him much.
Not that I'm aware of.
Right, he comes to Insomnia every time, and he's always one of those guys you don't want to play. Like, a lot of these Opens, there's players you've not heard of, you don't mind. Feli's one of those players you just don't want to walk into. He's just incredibly solid.
Okay.
Yeah, and we can see the classes up on the screen now. We see Druid, Hunter, and Shaman from Feli with the Warrior Band. Not too much of a surprise this tournament. And then we see Ness's lineup, the Warrior, Warlock, Druid, and Shaman as well. So just the Warlock and the Shaman, the Warlock and the Hunter, sorry, being the difference in the lineups. Like, what do you make of that? Because we don't actually know what Ness's decks are, but we have seen Feli so far.
Right, so Feli's deck, Feli's playing the Pantry Spider Hunter. Yep. He's playing a fairly greedy, but not as greedy. You know, a lot of people are playing the greedy Yogg with Arcane Giants and stuff now. And did we see his Warlock?
I don't think we did, actually.
So
no.
We didn't see his Warlock. And we haven't seen Ness's card. It said Ness's decks. They've been played off stream, and the decks have not been revealed to the players. So, you know, they could be pretty much anything. But
yeah, Ness has actually got a bit of an advantage then, because I have no doubt he would have been watching Feli's match at some point. If you're in the group with someone, you definitely try and watch everything you can, do all the research that's possible. That's sort of part of being at a live event or just an event that's streamed in general. Do you think that's going to, like, really favor Ness in terms, like, regardless of lineup, just having the information?
I guess it shouldn't be too much of importance. I think it gives you a little bit of an edge.
It helps.
But it helps, but it's not that tremendous.
Yeah. So we see now the players just getting ready. So we're going to see Feli versus Ness. And again, just to reiterate, the winner will go to top eight tomorrow. So This is the last chance for these guys. They are in the lower bracket of their group. They've already lost once already today. So this is going to be a tense match. And we saw Feli as well earlier on. I know Sottle mentioned it, like, earlier in his career, maybe had a few, like, slight mistakes himself and just not being able to focus too much in a high-pressure scenario. But he has had some good finishes himself as well.
Yeah, I mean, he streamed himself playing here two Insomnias ago, and I think he went something like 5-2 that day and got through to the later stage. There were several rounds to that, and he got through to the later stages of that as well. Just solid performer, like I said before. Ness, something that wasn't even shown on the video, even before the True Silver started, he came second at the old Insomnia, when it was mainly UK and a few Europeans. So Ness has been around for a long time. As you've said, he's getting better and better and more comfortable.
Yeah, and with Feli, his team, Isuba, they are always at the DreamHacks, you know, always at any LAN event as well. So they've got plenty of experience. I'm just wondering, like, what, Life Coach, because this is the first time I've had a chance to speak to you today, what do you think of the Warrior ban and that we've seen almost everyone ban Warrior out in the tournament?
Well, I guess it's very reasonable. I mean, Warrior was and is simply predominating. It has access to the very strongest 2-drop in the game, which is the Fiery Vorax. And with Dragon Warrior around, it's just a nearly unbeatable deck. Yeah, if you take the percentages and if you see the counters against Dragon Warrior, the best counters perform with a 53, maybe 54 percentage, which is pretty ridiculous for any kind of deck. That was probably the first deck where you can say that the best counter has like 54% against, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, the Knight of Karazhan obviously changes that, but at the moment there are only two wings released, which won't change it dramatically at the very moment. So yeah, I guess it's very reasonable.
Yeah, it looks like that is the deck to ban out in this tournament. But it looks like the game's starting, guys, so enjoy the match. Life Coach and Lorinda, take it away.
Thank you very much.
So, Life Coach, obviously Shaman versus Druid is quite close. Do you think that the Druid having this Innovate in his opening hand is the big deal, big swinger?
Well, absolutely. I mean, we were having this matchup basically the match before, and the key to success is that you have, as a Druid, is that you have this one ultra burst turn where you play Violet Teacher with something or Fendre with something. But usually that's too slow if you don't have access to either Wild Growth or Innovate. So yes, if you have not access to either Innovate or Wild Growth, you will usually use as the Druid player.
Right, and we see here Feli's kind of whiffed here on turn two, which is really unusual for Shaman deck to have nothing to do on turn two if it's not overloaded. And this is pretty punishing, I think, just to miss your turn two as a Shaman.
Absolutely, absolutely agree there. But there's also always the Tusker who can help to make out of the small misery.
Yeah. Yeah, Tusker, of course, having so many good options and very few bad ones. And even the bad ones, the very worst case, they still make your hero power a little bit better anyway.
Exactly. Exactly.
So while they're getting into this game, I want to ask you a question. I know you play a lot of Hearthstone, a lot of tournaments. You probably don't remember all of your games. Do you remember who you beat in the Swiss to get to the top 16 last year?
You.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, I know.
I was hoping you'd have forgotten that, but yeah.
No, absolutely. That was the last game. Yeah, yeah, sure.
That was a great day.
And it's not true that I don't. Actually, how you remember things or how you memorize things is usually through emotion. So if you connect, in general, whatever you want to learn, if you connect emotion with it, you're way better off. And it's not even twofold, but rather tenfold. And whenever I play, I'm very, very deeply emotionally attached to every game. So that means, usually I remember
those
games.
You remember many games. Awesome, man. Thank you. So we have this situation where Ness has not been forced into panicking here. He's been able to keep all his ramp, keep these swipes even. And now he's got Yogg if he's desperate. So he can proceed. Like many options, however he wants to do this now.
Yeah, absolutely. We also saw the Tusker not pulling, let's say, a super mighty totem. And that's very, very important for the Druid here, because if he doesn't get out-tempered, he will be able to stabilize.
Right, and obviously we made the point earlier that Shaman just can't play Earthshock at the moment. There's just not enough space with all these great Shaman cards to really stick an Earthshock in there currently. If the meta changes, you may have to. But
that's right.
Things like Ancient of War are just real roadblocks for the Shaman to get through.
Oh yeah, unless there is a 7-7. But it's true. We were also talking shortly about the turn 2 with the Maelstrom Portal. It's also very interesting, because if Druid would have had the Living Roots, which is usually a good deploy against Shaman, it would have gotten completely destroyed by Maelstrom Portal. And now it's exactly the other way around. We have Faeli having these double Maelstrom Portal in the hand. Druid just not delivering any kind of targets, which is kind of a little bit unusual for Druid. I mean, sometimes he floods the board, but he usually at least have the one or the other minion on the board where you can address the Maelstrom Portal onto. Not in this case, though.
Yeah, really unusual start to this game with both players sort of having no early, but they both got the early with a ton of talk and the innovate, but actually not getting a rolling start. They're both sort of hanging on in there to see what happens, and Faeli's going to have to put this 7-7 down now and force the issue.
It's just pretty damn big. I mean, 7-7 without the...
without the...
Okay.
What were you saying?
Yeah, no, it's perfectly fine. Yeah, I mean, just in time and bam. Yeah.
You didn't need it until now, so why draw it until now?
Absolutely.
Right, and that's going to be a massive deal, obviously, because next turn, if he wants to, he can innovate into Ancient of War. He may not even need to, depending exactly what pressure he's under.
Oh, he will probably do. And because of the overload, Shaman cannot really take... Knife Shackler being a very, very decent card here. But because of the overload, Shaman won't have the ability to flood the board. And Ancient of War, of course, completely blocking the entire aggression. Druid still being at 29, having access to board clear or board AoE in the hand, looks definitely very equal or even slightly favored for the Druid here.
And again, just making the points you've already made, unfortunately, but the Feral Rage will help him stabilize behind the Ancient of War.
Right.
The swipe will keep anything particularly nasty away in the time being, and he should be able to hang in there for a long time and then just go into that Yogg, and it should be good. There'll be a lot of spells cast.
Absolutely agree. We also see, now it really becomes tricky, right? I mean, he will probably use the Innervate because there is... no real other play. I mean, he doesn't want to deploy the Azedrake instead of the Ancient of War. But Azedrake into Swipe is also such a powerful play. But I think you cannot go for it. Oh, he even goes for
it. He's going for it.
Okay.
So he'll have more options next turn at least. And he'll actually be able to get that Giant down next turn if he wants to as well, won't he? 6-7, maybe he's one short, actually.
But
he can get that.
That's a very interesting play, to be honest, because... Faeli is playing double Maelstrom and Lightning Storm, so it's... do you know whether he plays two Lightning Storm? Oh, no, we didn't see
it. We haven't seen much. We saw him play the deck, we didn't see much of it.
Okay. The Azedrake is, very weak on board. I'm a little bit surprised that we didn't see Innovate. Whereas it's mid-range Shaman, so it contains Hex, right? So never mind. I think Azedrake is...
Forgetting there, it is a mid-range Shaman, because we've seen so much face Shaman. And this was just an aggro Shaman hand as well, so it did look there, obviously, like it was the aggro Shaman for a moment.
Yeah, with all these aggro Shaman around, you can sometimes easily forget that there is also the possibility of a mid-range Shaman, and that's exactly also what we see here. So obviously not playing the Ancient of War is perfectly correct, or was perfectly correct.
And now he's got plenty of time to go through the Giant into the Ancient of War and just get big things down. And although one will probably get Hex, and we haven't got the Hex, but there's a good chance in two or three turns he'll pick it up.
Yes.
Other than that, there's not many ways to make inroads here for Faeli.
I'm not even sure whether we will see Innovate into Giant coming down anyways, because there is also the possibility, well, okay, double Innovate. But I mean, keep in mind that if he just opts into Swipe and whatever, does something else, Swipe, Shapeshift, I mean, the Giant becomes cheaper and cheaper. You don't really want to play a Giant for 7 mana. You want to play the Giant for 2 mana, for 4 mana. So if he can combine it somewhat or somehow that the Giant will come down for very cheap, that's definitely what he wants to target.
Right, you have that extra bit of time against the mid-range Shaman, and he's on 25 life. He can afford to take the value, the greediness of getting that Giant's casting cost down, like you say, to as low as he dare. So we may just see... I mean, do you innovate into the Ancient? Do you waste the mana?
I would probably just swipe here. Just swipe and... Yeah.
Okay,
maybe
make him
just shapeshift into nothing, yeah. Maybe. I mean, followed by an Ancient of War, and then you still have the options. The Giant gets cheaper and cheaper. If Shaman really floods the board with a lot of minions, you still have access to Yogg-Saron. So, yeah.
Yeah, something I'm enjoying about Hearthstone at the moment is, we've seen it a lot today, is these... Most of the decks fill up their hands, apart from the obvious one or two face decks. Most of the decks fill up their hands. If hands are full, I mean, you're one of the guys who've known for this. Your hand is full, you have so many options to play to make.
Exactly, yeah, it's true. Yeah, the more you maximize your options, the more access to better plays you will have.
So every time you've got a chance to make a good play. Also, your opponent has a chance to make mistakes if you have lots of cards in hand, because they can't play around everything. They don't know what's in your hand exactly. They know roughly.
Yes, that's perfectly right. Yeah. So the more cards in the hand, the longer the game prolongs, the more decision-making is involved, and the more playing strength really becomes a predominating factor. That's for sure.
So I assume you're generally happy with how this is all coming out, like in general in Hearthstone, with just bigger hand sizes.
Absolutely. Yeah, sure.
Okay, so we see Feili trying not to just sort of empty his hand here, getting what he can out of what he's got. Smelling a bit of a rat as well, and you know, got to find a way to get through this 5-9. He's got to play around the swipe as well.
I mean, the swipe,
he may just
some
not
serious
be.
Work. I mean, Ezreal as a top deck would be so tremendous.
You're an evil man. You're an evil man. That's disgusting. That would actually just clear everything.
I mean, we see a swipe here and we see 7 targets, so okay, 6 targets. But it's still very, very sick.
Yeah, that 1-point attack there was just completely free, so yeah, he took the 1 free attack and that's that.
Right, right.
Okay, more choices for Ness. Regarding the Giant, basically, how many of these spells do you want to play? Do you want to play the Wild Growth? You might as well, but then it's a card you don't draw later.
Mm. Oh, you want to cycle the Wild Growth turn 10 for sure. So, probably, I mean, I guess swipe. Swipe is usually a good thing.
Does the swipe line up particularly well with this board right now, though? I mean, it's usually, like you say, it's usually good, but it doesn't line up that great with all these 2/3s and 2/2s.
Oh yeah, it absolutely doesn't. But you also want to get rid of the Knife Juggler, right? So. Mm-hmm. It's not the ideal use, but on the other hand, there are 6 targets. And I mean, what are the other options? Let's ask like this, right? So the other options would be slamming the Giant for 7 mana. I don't think that's a really viable option. So yeah. I think you just do what Ness just did. I mean, you could have swiped and innovated into the Giant, right? That would have been a possibility.
Oh yeah, that would have got some big stuff on the board, but.
Maybe I would have liked to see that one, like swipe into innovate Giant, but yeah, I guess that's also perfectly fine, sure.
So when you're in a position like this, what do you do with your Yogg? Obviously, you feel like you're slightly in front with your Giant coming down next turn, presumably. So do you just plan to never use your Yogg and keep it as an emergency, or do you still try to pave the way so you can get it down at some point?
No, I think as long as you're ahead, you just stay ahead and play your game without Yogg. And once you fall behind, well, the game state will definitely indicate when Yogg's time has come.
Yogg's time will come, most likely, in this as well. Although, you know...
That's expensive here, these hits. That's 5. That's another 5.
Just a casually taking 10. Of course, when you're the aggressive deck, which you still are with this deck, even as mid-range, you can afford to take 10 to your face because you have to. Right? You have to win the game before they stabilize.
Sure, but 10 is... It's really expensive. It's really expensive, so I'm not sure.
I seem to remember, actually, you're less of a fan of taking damage than most people. If you don't have to take it, it's like, why take 10 if you don't need to take 10?
No, but I guess in this position, boy, it was perfectly fine.
He's out of resources, so that's the only way to generate resources is to use your life as an extra resource.
Yeah, that's exactly the thing. I mean, he's out of cards, so yes. I mean, he doesn't mind if he dies in the next X turns. Mm. But if he would have had still access to, let's say, four cards, one of it is Mana Tide, mm-hmm. maybe in Hex, maybe something else to stay in play. I don't know. But in this case, it was obviously very, very correct to do it.
So here's Yogg. So now it just needs to clear. He's got the sprint, that's the hand fill. Anything else, he just now almost certainly wins the game.
First cut sprint, second cut kills the door. Oh. That is so disgusting. Look at this. Rasp, but only. And if this is Yogg, it doesn't give Yogg. Ramp.
Wow.
Oh man.
Yogg again now.
That's so sick. Such a good Yogg. That was an insanely good Yogg. Whoa.
Whoa. Just in case you didn't want to take 4 damage, we'll just stop that as well.
That was pretty
just
good.
Just 5 at the end of this Yogg as well. No, not even this 4 damage.
That was pretty sick, yeah, sure.
So now the Feral Rage can be used for that 8 life gain, for that 8 extra armor.
Yeah, oh, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, in this position.
So this is where you start having to play strangely, because you start looking at what is the only way I can lose. So you start making strange plays to just make sure you don't lose the game, because you're so far in front.
Well, I guess you just opt in for the strange play to get infinite life and then slash giants for free. And then
that seems quite good.
Then you're very good to go, yeah. So.
Okay, so Raven Idling first, still keeping his mechanics proper, so he knows what his turn's going to be. That's always good to see when somebody's shows they're concentrating and in the zone. They're well in front.
Oh yeah.
Taking Claw for another 2 armor as well.
Yeah.
Just getting everything as safe as possible, because it's going to take some craziness for him to lose, so why not just get as much? Yeah. Just taking the 2 armor, not even, he'll kill the 0-2, but that's not why he did it.
Yeah, I guess in this position, with the 2 giants coming down, I guess the shaman can press the concede button.
Yeah, I agree. But again, I don't advocate that in a tournament like this.
No, you don't.
May do something crazy.
No, I didn't want to advocate it. I just want to point out that
you're correct. I think it's the time-efficient play.
Yes, exactly. That was my point. Yeah, Well played.
A few Ness fans in the crowd, I think we can hear there as well.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so game one, just the innovate really from the start. Like, he managed to use that fairly slow draw plus the innovate for Ness.
Yeah, I guess it was just a very bad shaman curve. I mean, as you pointed out, the turn 2 was basically adding 0 attack stats onto the board. Turn 3 added a 3-2 and a 1-1 instead of something much better, which could have also just happened right away. So three of the 7 totem would have been way, way better. So it's not even that unlikely, right?
Yeah, and even the fact it's a 1-1, not a 0-2, gets swiped is like the worst one. Probably.
Absolutely, yeah, mm-hmm. Sure.
Okay, so one of the things with Last Hero Standing, if you start winning with a deck like Druid that can sweep, your opponent needs to win what we call the counter match, but really Hearthstone at the moment doesn't have counters like the olden days.
Yeah, at the moment, not at the moment. I once explained it also on my stream that. With, let's say, taking out mechanics like the Molten Giant, the game mechanics become a little bit, let's say, more straightforward. Mm-hmm. And with also taking out cards like, let's say, a little bit of Silence, but mainly also AoE, like Blade Flurries, the game simply gets simpler and more curve decks appear, because the answers are, at the very moment, just not good enough to respond to the questions. Mostly one-to-one, so either you have the answer, then you made a break-even trade, you don't have the answer, you just get overrun, and that results in a lot of curve decks, and curve is usually of roughly equal strength, which also then means, I mean, if you try to counteract a curve deck with another curve deck, chances that you don't counter it by 60% is also pretty clear.
Sure, so cards like the portals, are you in favor of those? Cards that break up the curve a little bit, help you to kill something, get a thing on your side? Swing cards like that?
Yes, definitely yes. Yeah, I mean AoE, stronger AoE, stronger responses. So cards like Shield Slam. Yeah. Shield Slam is a very strong response, and you cannot play it in a very aggressive deck. So these are the cards which basically enable control decks to be in the meta.
Excellent. And so hopefully they carry on sort of working on that. Obviously the game, we feel like we've been playing Hearthstone forever. It's 2 years old. Everybody's still learning,
yes,
you know, about making the cards as well as playing the cards.
Exactly.
Okay, so both got a pretty good hand here. As we see, just the Violet Teacher hitting the board. This needs an answer soon. Or you just answer with the Fandral.
Well, I guess you just mulch it. I mean, you saw Giant, so you don't want to be too deliberate with your mulches. But still, I mean, another play would only be the Myra Keeper, right? I mean, which is also definitely a possibility. Myra Keeper for mana and then just hope that the Violet Teacher won't break you.
Yeah, I guess he has no swipe as backup if he wanted to go with that, so...
That's a problem.
And the thing with mulch, I think people overestimate how bad it is for your opponent. Like, most of the time it isn't very usable, and if it's a good card, it might be something you can't even do for six more turns, so...
Exactly.
You've got plenty of time to get out of trouble that way as well.
Yeah, I'm not thinking that the problem is that Ness will receive a big mulch card, but I think the problem might be that that he doesn't have access to the mulch for the Giants later on.
So Feili choosing to use the way that he can deal with this, that costs him his coin, but it's also dealt with the problem efficiently otherwise.
That's right. Also pointing out that usually 8 armor is not that valuable in this matchup, and 4 attack, well, it's usually bad, so why not use it now? I can definitely see it.
Yeah, and he's got plenty of curve coming up to Azurdrake into Fandral, Hero Power, something like that over the next few turns. Or he may just Myra Keeper, we'll see.
Exactly. We can also shortly point out that if Feili wouldn't have gone for this clear line to clear the Teacher, he probably would have just lost the game by now.
He would just, no swipe, and he's going to just get Power of the Wilder, and everything's just going to, all hell's going to break loose. And now, actually, Ness has no... Like, you don't really want to Living Roots particularly. It sort of gives away your hand a little bit.
Yeah.
Swipe just irons it out.
Yeah, you don't want to do any of those. that's right.
You don't really want to play Power of the Wild. You don't want to do nothing. A lot of Hearthstone players are bad at doing nothing.
Yeah.
Like learning players especially.
Mm-hmm.
Like, sometimes you just have to do nothing. That's the best play occasionally.
Yeah. I guess with Teacher already out, you might not aim for the roots. Maybe in creating this 3-2, but I wouldn't mind not to do it.
Mm-hmm.
I like to keep it in the hand. I'm not even sure about the roots, to be honest. Depending on his deck build, the 2/1s are better or worse.
I guess he wants to play something.
Did you already see that Maligos?
Not that I saw earlier. I was taking notes earlier, but no.
Okay. I mean, that very strongly indicates Barnes, and it might also indicate something like Moonfires, maybe? Or just playing it for the
power. Moonfires with Gadget Sands, one option as well. Many options, in fact. You can do crazy things. And like you say, Maligos on its own, it's just a 4/12 that does a lot of good things.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'm not even sure about the Auctioneer, because you can probably not stuff it in the deck, but I guess if you play Maligos, you might be inclined to perhaps play Moonfire. I mean, it's really not a good card, but I guess Maligos without Moonfires looks a little bit weird to me.
Yeah, Moonfire is interesting because it isn't a good card, but if you can replace it, or if it's... We've seen that one damage is worth a lot more. Now it's minion versus minion, versus stat. One damage is worth more than it was maybe 6 months ago.
Exactly. And you also have access to other spell power, right? So you can, let's say, keep the Moonfire for the Maligos. And if in the game you have a good one damage target or an Azurdrake and a good two damage target, you can also just use it a little bit earlier. So
we'll see if that's in there as the game progresses, no doubt. Ness is still having this problem where he wants to play spells to make the Arcane Giant cheaper, but all of his spells are things he wants to keep for other situations, so he's going to have to do some things, probably use this,
I guess he's thinking about cycling the Wrath, and I would probably do so, because his hand at the very moment is entirely dead, so if you don't cycle the Wrath here and now, you basically have an entire dead turn 7 if you don't top deck something useful. And I don't think that you can ever risk that one.
Right. Just to point out to people watching, obviously Ness will know roughly what this deck is. They did play earlier today. So, you know, even though we're sitting there going, we're not quite sure, Ness will know better than us what's in this deck right now.
Absolutely. The line Ness has took is probably a little bit inconsistent, because last turn he opted in to play nothing over the Panther. And this turn he could have even shapeshifted with the mana instead of creating the Panther, and he chose to Panther despite that.
Yeah.
So it's even +1 shapeshift better than last turn, and he still does it, where he opted in not to do it last turn. He drew the second power of the Wild.
Yeah,
I'm
just
wondering
if he, for whatever reason, he maybe thinks he needs to keep one power of the Wild
exactly.
and play the other. On his mind, maybe to have an explosive turn seven turns from now.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, one reason would be to keep the power of the Wild if you draw a Teacher or a Fendril. But I have to say, if you draw a Teacher or a Fendril, well, maybe. I mean, you cannot play everything next turn, but you probably might be later. So I don't see it
and
be that.
Faili's spoiled for choice here. I mean, he's got so many plays that just jump out at you and say they're good plays. Like just Thumb Swipe, just being the obvious basic play.
Sure.
Right through to just developing more mana or developing Fendril. He can do what he likes, yeah.
I really like the Myra Keeper here. Myra Keeper for mana and Shapeshift on the 1-1. Because the swipe is just valuable in this matchup, and he knows. So I really agree with this line of play.
Also, he has a very, very powerful hand, but it costs you a lot of mana to get that hand doing its work. So
yeah.
I feel like getting this mana now, it's an investment for the future, which... I was saying earlier, I think Druid is the class where you most worry, you think about the future and your potential draws more than any other class, I feel.
Absolutely, and also Fendril. I mean, regarding Fendril, the more mana, the better he is, and it's really exponential. So maybe not straight up exponential, but really, a lot of mana, Fendril equals very good.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. If you get two cards instead of one, it's like worth more than double. Like that's what you're saying. Cool.
Yeah, basically activation costs four mana, and then you can do stuff with either two or three or four additionally.
Yeah. Okay, so Ness drawing more and more spells, which is going to work out for this giant, but it's running him out of cards really quickly. So if this attack fails, and it's looking like it probably will with the Swipe, the Wrath, the Fandral, before we even talk about the other cards, Ness is going to be really up against it when this Maligos, followed by even Yogg, possibly come to town.
But the Azure Drake, for example, was a very good draw because, I mean, as we mentioned, he was kind of out of cards, and the Azure Drake is probably, well, one of the best top decks he could have hoped for in this position.
It drew him the card, but not only did it draw him the card, it allowed him to draw the other card from the Wrath whilst not taking any, you know, mess. And now the Power of the Wild is being used for hitting.
Okay, so what do we have here? Interesting, yeah. I mean, if the board would have been one smaller, it would have been very easy. Now it becomes a little bit more complicated.
So, yeah, five is an awkward number for Druid at this stage to deal with efficiently. They can do it. They can obviously do 4+1, but that wastes two more mana. And we've said earlier, Faili's only weakness here is he just needs to get these cards. If he plays these cards, he's in his hand now, he will win this game.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I mean, he has only power cards in his hand at the very moment. Ness still has one giant, and also the draws he will have access to in the next one or two turns. So it's not that Ness is completely out of cards. It will be really interesting to see what's going
on. Faili's going to draw, the fact he's doing this first. Which and then just swipe.
Yeah, which is also very interesting regarding he also had or already has the Fendril in the hand. So Brass, or to utilize the Brass, is kind of more expensive than usual because Fendril in combination with Brass can deal 4 damage and can replace a card.
Right, and he's going to have to mulch, unfortunately for him, this 8-8. What he'd love to do is to Maligos and use like Living Roots and other bits and pieces. To take it down efficiently.
Well, I mean, unfortunate. I don't know about this, unfortunate, because the Fendril into Living Roots is still a very strong answer on the 4-2, and he also can mulch, so I think it's okay. I mean, mulch on an 8-8, you definitely don't complain.
Yeah.
But here, I would definitely do the Fendril, wouldn't you? I mean,
yeah, it's fine. I think your Fendril, you get the 2/1/1s just to answer any teacher tokens that come up as well.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, he opts in to play the giant, which is also perfectly fine. But I'm not sure whether, I mean, maybe he's doing more. Maybe it's right, because the Fendril could also not kill the teacher right away. So maybe it's good. Maybe it's even correct.
Right, so that Infestor Torrent is an interesting thing from the mulch.
Ooh, my aww.
Now his own mulch.
That's pretty damn good. He needed the answer, there it is. So that's pretty good.
So you know what time it is? I think it's Yogg time.
Absolutely. At the moment, only on one side, but that can quickly change.
So if you had the choice, and you almost never have the choice, would you rather Yogg first or would you rather Yogg second? If you both have Yogg in hand.
Interesting,
you don't usually have the choice, but...
Well, I guess it doesn't matter that much, right?
So the theory being maybe use Yogg to answer their Yogg to clear up their mess that they
Yeah, I really don't think
it matters that much. I don't think it comes up much, as a strategic decision very often, just as a, if it happens to go that way, I think you would rather put it down second personally, maybe.
Yeah, but maybe it's a little bit of bias, because it probably means that you drew your bombs first, he needed to clear them off with your York, then you can counter his York, but he still has all the threats in his deck.
Right.
So I'm not exactly sure.
That makes sense.
But usually you don't need to decide, right? Usually you just play him and that's it. But we see a Moonfire here, and that's also what we were already having in mind. Interesting, and now he goes for York. He might have also opted in, but that would have been probably more risky, to play Maligos into Moonfire, right?
So I've made this play once with this deck when I was playing these decks before this tournament just to get a feel. And I find that if you play the Moonfire there, it's actually, you would rather have the Moonfire with the Maligos later than play the extra one spell with Yogg now. So I'll be interested to see what the last Yogg spell is, just because that's not how numbers really work.
That's going to be crazy. Look at this Yogg. Did you see the only beneficial and super sick, guys. sorry. But that's a super sick. No, seriously. I mean, did you just see that?
So now he has quite a good board.
Yeah, I mean the teacher is still alive.
And he may die.
No, but that's, I mean, the Yogg just brought, draw two cards, +2/+2 on all your minions, another +2/+2, then these portals, I mean, just pure value, +2/+2 and a minion. I mean, this Yogg was just so amazing. I mean, just look at the board. and the 5/4, it draws you a card.
So into swipe, right? This into swipe for the game.
Not yet.
But now is swipe enough? Swipe's not enough now, right?
No, it's one shot now.
So now he needs to get something crazy. Something even crazier than that Yogg just was. But he hasn't insta-picked anything. There we go.
Mark is also short, is it? It's 5, 8, 10. It's one. Oh, is it even short? Yeah, it's
one off. It's one short.
Yeah, it's one mana or one damage card, right? It's crazy. That's
so it. I think he needs to take the mulch just to not die.
That's so silly.
Yogg-Saron, ladies and gentlemen. We give you Yogg-Saron. All start praising him now. And after that, buy your tickets for 25% off for next Insomnia.
Right.
Okay.
But he goes for the face for the 3 damage. Which is interesting, 3 damage to the face, that's... No.
Do you know that Moonfire would be handy?
What is it now? You can Fendral into Nourish, right? Do you do that? Yeah, probably.
Yeah, I think
You don't Nourish plainly, right? You do Fendral into Nourish. It's only 3 mana more expensive. It's only 3 mana more expensive, and you already have Fendral on the board then.
Yeah.
But yeah.
There's a swipe. That swipe was urgently required. Is it enough? It should be enough, right?
Yeah. The swipe is pretty good, yeah. Let's see. That's 14.
Wow.
Yeah, I guess he can... Yeah, I mean, he can obviously clear the board, but I also think that he can do so in a very nice way. Let's see. Was it right?
A lot of time pressure on this one, so...
Absolutely, yeah. Very...
Time pressure, and he knows a single mistake here, and he just dies with 3 life, so... Just playing it as he sees it, which is sometimes the only way you can do it in Hearthstone. 70 seconds is shorter than it seems at times. Okay, so it's all about, you know, can Ness draw the win before he dies in 2 or 3 turns at most?
I also have to say that the Darkfish... Darkfish is such a troll.
Yeah, it looked like a great board, but it's also a very whispers board. Yogg's just sort of saying, yeah, you can have these things, but your opponent can have things too.
That's right. Now you can Fendral into the idol, right?
Yeah.
I guess you have to.
And the minion here is important. You can sometimes win the game with a Leroy or something crazy from the minion part of it. Anyone look to the spell?
Yeah, but this is not...
What?
Oh, okay. That's one of those will do it. At least...
Yeah, whichever one he sees is the right way here.
Nefarian is an interesting choice. I don't think I would have picked the Nefarian with such a big, expensive card. He also had access to the 3/4, right? That could have fit better in the curve.
It just feels like you're never going to play this Nefarian in this game. You either die to your opponent's swipe or whatever first, or you have a massive board anyway. Your opponent's not clearing Auctioneer, Emperor, Maligos.
Exactly.
Game.
Exactly. So I think if you would have had access to the Stream Mastery for maybe even Doomsayer, but probably not. But I mean Nefarian.
Sure, Nefarian, I mean, it's not a problem, it's just, yeah.
So he opts in for the Savagery, which is interesting. He could have dealt for 5 mana 5 damage, but that's probably inferior. What? He could have 5? It was tougher, right? So it's 5 mana 7 damage, right? But yeah, still, I mean.
Again, just time pressure, he's making sure he doesn't.
No, I'm not saying it would have been better, I'm just saying that Starfall could have dealt 7 damage. He might have opted in for it.
This Ancient's going to be a big problem this time around. And again, I don't think it's a mistake as such, but not keeping that Moonfire for the Yogg.
Oh, there's a Wrath. Panikos. There's a Wrath.
Easy game.
I mean, it's not enough, but I'm sure he will find something with the Wrath or with the Wild Growth or with whatever. So he has a lot of options.
And Soto was saying this to you earlier, Druid's surprisingly resilient. It finds a way to do more and more things a lot of the time.
Oh, you was right on the Auctioneer, by the way.
Yeah. So,
what is with the Auctioneer even? You could have played the... but probably it's too slow. But you could have also played the Auctioneer, draw 3 cards with the White Rose.
Yeah.
So it would have been pretty good.
But you had to have drawn exactly sort of Innovate and something else, right?
Yeah, it's correct, yeah. So I also...
Wow, this Feral Rage is absolutely great for him.
It just hurts my heart that the 2 Auctioneers are dead in the hand at the very moment. But it's definitely correct not to play them because you needed the answer.
It also gives the Nefarian a little bit more of an instinctive pull. I don't necessarily think I was necessarily the right choice from Nefarian, but Auctioneer into Nefarian into 2 more spells, into draw some more cards.
Right.
Your brain just goes, oh, this is the card I'm looking for.
Right, yeah, sure.
And now the swipe finally comes into Ness's hand, but it's too late. Well, it's not too late, but it's too late for the immediate win.
One turn later, yeah, it's exactly one turn too late for immediate lethal. But I really like this game, how it is playing out, because Ness is in the front and he's always putting this one threat which would kill Faeli, and Faeli always finds the answer just right in time to counter it off, but not enough to seize the entire board control.
Yeah, and the irony is now he's got the Auctioneers and he hasn't got a spell in his hand anymore.
Yeah.
So exactly. Suddenly he's... Oh, and I've just realized Nefarian's going to get him Druid spells. I mean, that's obvious, we know this, but I mean, it's only just...
Well, Nefarian,
but... It just dawned on me, he's going to get spells that he needs for his deck, so...
Yeah, but I guess the first time where he has the luxury to do anything else than defending, it will always be probably Water Elemental and Emperor Thoris, and it will never be Nefarian.
Yeah.
Exactly. It's like the incarnation of Mega Slow, right?
Yes.
It's like 9 mana, do nothing this turn, and probably not that much next turn either.
Okay, so Ness is all in on the plan of I'm just going to kill you before your cards start to do things. And just looking at Faeli's deck, he's only got something like 6 cards left.
Oh, Moonfire.
So that's another answer.
No, that's Meligos. That's Meligos, Moonfire.
Yeah, Meligos, Moonfire.
And, but I really didn't like Ness's line here. I would have always went for the Thorin there here. Just utilizing Swipe, I mean, I don't even know whether we can call it utilizing, but just using Swipe to deal 4 damage in the opponent's face, if he doesn't die, seems to be a very, very bad thing if you can do something else. What do you think?
Yeah, I think you might as well keep the 4 mana. You're going to kill him anyway.
Yeah,
if
exactly.
You can kill him. Yeah. So you can, you know, not arouse suspicion, keep it in your hand, and it may have a different use. And I'm just going to say one last time, but this is why I'd have kept the Moonfire before the Yogg.
Yeah.
Such a damaging spell, and one extra Yogg spell. Yogg's damaging because of the whole range of stuff it does.
Right.
But this is a very specific recovery after the Yogg. It's Maligos, kill your next thing.
Yeah, that's right.
And Ness now drawing into Innovate, which is obviously pretty rough for him. Faeli's finally got some control of the board, and he's going to have enough stuff to be able to deal with. We may never see these Auctioneers played on this game.
I mean, I don't want to say it, but would have not the other order simply won for Ness? Because if he would have first played the Tauren, he could have delivered 2 more damage, if I see it right, and that would have then ceased out the game. I mean, that's in hindsight, of course, but...
So it did 3. Would the Tauren have done 4? Would it have been 1 more?
No, yeah, the Tauren would have only been delivered 2 damage.
Yeah, yeah.
It would have simply been 2
so
more.
It would have been just simply 2 more. And yeah, so he would have won the game if he'd done it the other way. Good spot.
Only in hindsight.
We're not sat there either. We can't see both hands.
Exactly.
So he can't see both hands. You know what I mean. And it's still really close even now.
It's crazy. It's absolutely crazy. I mean, even Living Roots top deck, I think he played both already, right?
Yeah, and it should be over, but Feili does have to kill him. I think that's like three.
Oh, he is. It's like,
wow.
He didn't play both. Yeah, I was wondering. That is so sick.
He gets there, and that's 2-0, and that was one really exciting game there. And Ness takes a 2-0 lead, and he gets to use his Druid a third time in a row. That's how Last Hero Standing works.
It was a great game.
Yeah.
An absolutely great game. The entire game, extremely borderline, every single turn, and even much more exciting for us spectators, because we knew there was no answer available for Faeli. Every single turn, and every single turn he managed to somehow top deck it, dodge the lethal. We knew every top deck from Ness could have killed him. In the end, he succeeded in top decking the lethal, but super exciting.
Yeah, really good game of Hearthstone. One or two points we pulled up again with the benefit of being able to sit here in luxury up here and look at both hands. But maybe taking that Nefaria, which never got played.
Yeah.
Could have been just a 3-4, which may have been able to tidy things up a little bit better earlier. Who knows?
Right. But to be fair, he didn't have any mana at any point of the game. But yeah, Nefarian really didn't do any kind of job. So.
Okay, so we're going into this Pantry Spider. What do you think of this card in Hunter?
Well, I guess how I see it is probably simply the replacement for the Carrion Crab, if you want to play the Carrion Crab. And I think that the Pantry Spider might be a slightly tiny bit better than the Carrion Crab. But I think nowadays with the big pool Hunter has access to, I would probably opt out playing Carrion Crab nowadays.
I believe you've played a lot of Hunter since the recent cards.
Oh yeah.
How are you finding the class? What do you think of it?
I hope that it will be successful. I mean, I can see a lot of potential with the Cloaked Huntress, which reduces your secrets to zero mana, which is kind of good. And on paper, it really looks great on paper. We have all the secrets. We have the bow, which charges up whenever a secret pops up. We have the Ketrick, and the Ketrick produces the cat in the head, and it really looks amazing, as well as a golden card, as well as the cat in the head if it jumps out.
Wow.
So I would be really surprised if you could make something out of it.
And is it a complicated deck, do you feel, if it's got all these synergies going on? Do you have to make sure you get the bow in the right order with the Huntress at the right time and so on? Or is it going to be just another curve deck?
Yeah, I think it... I would assume that it's not tremendously difficult to be played, but I would assume that it's tremendously difficult to be built. Yeah,
right.
Because you have so much variety.
So somebody's going to come to a tournament under the radar and blow it out with Hunter, maybe.
Well, maybe, yeah.
Because they built it right, not because they played it right necessarily.
Definitely. You have such a range. You can play Secret Keepers, you cannot play Secret Keepers. You can play 6 secrets, you can play up to 10 secrets. You can play passive secrets, active secrets. It's crazy, yeah. You can play with animal synergy, without animal synergy, with Barnes plan, without, with Death Rattle plan, without.
And you've got to pick 50-50 choices all the way through yes, no, yes, no, yes, no, and build a synergetic deck. Lovely.
Maybe you can just flip coins for each of those decisions. And in
random deck, see which one you get lucky with. There's 30 million of us. One of us will flip, right?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying, yeah.
Okay, so Ness facing down an early beatdown, and he has no swipe. What's his plan? Is it to try and nourish into an answer immediately, or otherwise he's going to be folding up and dying pretty soon?
I don't think that you have the luxury to just utilize nourish for card draw. I mean, you just fall behind so much. We already see 7 damage on the board, which I'm probably rather more because of the knife juggler. I would not be surprised to see a nourish for mana here. Yeah. He just doesn't have the luxury to do it for cards. He would die.
Yep. So he's just taking the chance that he will get to do 2 things a turn, a few of these turns. And as you see already, he's going to get to Fandral and Fel Rage next turn, which if it's a desperation play,
yep.
Or he can do other things as well, maybe get the other nourish going. He's got a lot of options depending what he draws.
Yeah, but to be fair, Hunter just had the early game. Druid didn't do anything besides ramping up just a little bit. So, yeah, it looks very, very bad for the Druid here and very, very good for the Hunter.
Absolutely brutal. When Hunter gets going, it just has this green button with 2 on it, and that's how much it smashes you for each and every turn. And the Druid's not going to have time to even armor up to take this damage away. It's going to be all hands on deck just killing stuff.
Yeah, I mean, he just doesn't have the time. I mean, there is Feral Rage, and I mean, he might be able. I mean, with the Fenrir, with the Feral Rage, I mean, you see that the Nourish for creating mana
yes,
made this happen
this.
Now. Yeah, allowed this. So that's pretty good. 8 armor and kill. You killed the knife juggler. You definitely killed the knife juggler here, right? Oh.
Yeah, because the knife juggler is going to do at least one more for sure next turn anyway. That's the 3 versus the 3. Plus, there's no need to proc the frog if you don't have the toad if you don't have to.
Yeah, there's a reasoning to be made that because of the animal and the houndmaster, which would be of insane insanely big value. But you should know that there is no houndmaster because Faili would have probably already played the houndmaster last turn for sure. So you really don't need to take care of the animal.
And he's now drawn the death sentence.
Oh yeah.
You've got 3 turns to live, sir. What do you want to do with your final meal?
You play Hunter's Mark here, right? For what? You're so afraid of Ancient of War that you keep the Hunter's Mark here, really. That surprised me a little bit. I mean, you can just...
He may still play it. Faili's a very deliberate player. He likes to weigh up every option. Like I say, he's played a lot of these events before and done reasonably well, but without anyone really picking up on him before.
Yeah, not sure. But I mean, just compare the lines. If you could have just Hunter's Mark, I mean, Hunter's Mark is 1 mana deal 4 damage here.
Right.
And it's not even 1 mana, because it's 0 mana, right? Because he doesn't play it. So it's basically 1 card to deal 4 damage. And
so maybe he's thinking the only way he loses to the Giants, or to maybe an
Ancient of War.
So he's just keeping it for the emergency that is those 2 cards. The Ancient War would, of course, slow him right down.
Right. But I cannot see that Ancient of War is the only card he loses against. I guess... Right. He loses against, but any kind of swipe can just bring Druid immediately back into action. I mean, swipe just cleans the board, completely swipes it clean, and Call of the Wild comes in, 3 turns? So, I guess utilizing this Hunter's Mark, just hoping there is no Ancient of War. I mean, even if there is an Ancient of War, it's not so insanely much worse. But if there is no Ancient of War, it's just so much better that I probably would have just gone for it.
Okay, Ness taking down all the things he can, but... Still this Hunter getting ever closer to turn 8 while still delivering damage with this board that's just been sat there, and Pantry Spider is going to be irritating at the very least here.
You could have also opted in on Ness behalf instead of playing the Azure Drake and the Shapeshift to stay mana effective with the Mirror Keeper and the Violet Teacher. Violet Teacher having kind of soft taunt and just creating a so much bigger and better board than Ness opted in. And I don't even know what he wanted to draw with the Drake, because he was at 3 mana after the Drake deploy, and Druid's cap is usually at 4 mana. So swipes, for example, and stuff like this. So the really best thing as might have wanted to draw would have been a Wrath, but next turn he would have already have the option to still draw the Wrath or the swipe within 3 cards instead of 1. So maybe that would have also been a line which could have been considered to be taken.
Right. Sometimes when you're up against Hunter like this, you make the opinion, I am going to Hero Power every turn to slow down the damage. Just that extra 1 armor.
Right.
Maybe he just fell into that mode of, I'm just going to armor every turn just because I'm dying. But your play did seem to get some stuff on the board in case you did draw into an answer.
Exactly. I mean, the thing is, first you stabilize and then you take care of your life.
Yeah.
It's not, I mean, now he just loses at the very pace.
Fell Rage, just to buy another turn.
Yeah, but it's just... I mean, at this pace, he just loses whatever. 7, 8, 9 life every turn. You can play 1 Feral Rage every turn against this if you want, but it won't change the fact. Rather the opposite, because Hunter can just build up the board and just increase the damage output per turn from 8 to 10 to 12 to 15. So, yeah.
So something that tells me you were probably right about the Hunter's Mark is that it's still there.
Oh, yeah.
That's usually the thing. If you have a turning point in a match and you think, should I or shouldn't I play this card? And it's very, very close a lot of the time. If it's still there at the end of the game,
right.
You should have done it earlier. Probably. It's results orientated, but it's an alert that maybe you should have played this card earlier.
Yeah, probably. I mean, even if the Ancient of War comes down now, you would still not play the Hunter's Mark because you would, of course, prioritize the Call of the Wild over it.
So, I mean, you could go the other way and say, well, he's won without it, so he saved it for the... double Ancient of War.
Sure.
So you can go either way with that argument, of course, but I like to think that if I've got a turning point, I look to see, is that card still there? When did I use that card?
Yeah, that's definitely a good way of thinking.
Okay, so just going through the motions in game 3 here. It's going to be almost certainly 2-1 to Ness after this game. And although the last game we wrote him off once or twice, this time, Hunter has the inevitability of the Hero Power.
Did you, by the way, also count the knives? The knife juggler already threw?
It must be 5 or 6.
Probably.
So. It's it's a lot. It isn't because the Call of Wild hasn't got it. It's three or four.
Because you talked about the possibility of doing it different.
So that would have made a pretty big difference there. As we see, 2-1 now to Ness, but as with Last Hero Standing, how it works out, if you've already got the 2-0 lead, you get your choice of now that you really want to go for. And your opponent's stuck with their Hunter.
That's right.
So this is personal preference. When you get two decks left, you're 2-1 ahead. Mm-hmm. You've got to play them both anyway at some point if you're going to win. How do you prefer to do it? Do you like to get it over with and go with the one that's likely to win, or do you like to...
I think because as you pointed out, you have to win with one of those two decks. You have to play both of them. If you lose, you can just go for the strategical best decision, which is usually information deception. So I would just go for the deck where you would think that it makes the mulligan of your opponent not much easier. So if you have a deck, maybe you have a warrior and your opponent doesn't know which one it is, and then it's really difficult to mulligan it against that. But you have a warlock and that's probably Zoo. Well, then you just go for the warlock to not to reveal too much information.
Right, that sounds good. Especially in a tournament like this where there are no decks revealed and so on as well. So.
Exactly.
Okay, so he's gone with the Zoo against this Hunter deck, and that's one good looking Zoo hand.
Also just about this information deception thing, it's way more important in a banned format. Because your opponent, if he knows, if he has full knowledge of your decks, might ban something else.
Right, so you can make them make a mistake because they think they're doing the sensible thing. Let's ban Warrior because it's Warrior, but actually your Warrior's not good.
Exactly, yeah. One example would have been the OTK Warrior. You have Freeze Mage in your lineup, so that would be very good against OTK Warrior, but super bad against any other kind of Warrior. Things like that.
So this matchup, I mean, there were times when Hunter was massively favourite against Zoo, and then recently Zoo's become massive favourite against Hunter. I assume this is now somewhere in between the two.
Okay. Well, usually Zoo should be a big favourite, I mean big favourite, but definitely 60-40 over Hunter at least. If they only run one Unleash or zero Unleash, it's even worse. But we also see some, let's say, Flame Juggler things, which are not super standard, which might help the Hunter a little bit.
Right, so... Ness's plan here, we haven't seen a dogs, we haven't seen Unleash the Hounds at all.
Right.
So Ness will probably be fairly comfortable just making the biggest board possible here, I would think.
Yeah, whereas at the moment his hand looks a little bit, well, I mean he will probably tap, yeah.
Yeah, those two pickups were not the best and he's going to have to just survive this next turn or two and then start doing Zoo things with that Direwolf in a minute.
Exactly. So we have double Call of the Wild here. I mean, we know that Call of the Wild is a very, very strong card, but having it in the hand as a Hunter turns three, both of them, is the biggest punishment I guess you can encounter.
Yeah, that's the thing that makes Hearthstone beautiful. Your best cards, you don't want them until it's the right time.
Right.
So you can't just jam your deck full. It's like the whole thing the game is built around is that, you know, value versus tempo.
That's right. And what we can also assume from seeing Fraeli's hand is that this Hunter is a face Hunter, it's an aggressive Hunter. So a lot of very cheap cards, which means that the Call of the Wild are probably by far the most expensive card in his deck. I'm not even sure whether he runs high mains or one or zero. So really unlucky, because that also means that his hand will fatigue way quicker, will... run out of cards way quicker.
Because there are two cards that he doesn't have right now. He's just got two blank spaces there for now. He's only got two cards in hand, effectively, for now.
Exactly. That is one reason, but the other reason is that his deck is probably cheaper overall.
Right.
Which means he probably runs out of cards by turn 6, and then probably has an empty turn 7 before he has access to the power 8 cards.
Yep. And in the meantime, Zoo just loves people who miss a turn. That's why Zoo's always the best deck at the start of a new meta, because people are experimenting with new stuff. And Zoo just says, I don't like your new stuff, I'm just going to kill you while you mess around.
Exactly.
So.
Yep. We have the kill command to address the 2-5, but unfortunately no animals.
Yep, no beast, and Feili doing that thing we were talking about earlier, which is he needs to get this hero power in as many times as possible, but animal companion is the obvious play. But then animal companion just going to die to the councilman. He's got a very difficult looking turn here.
Oh, yeah. Especially because Hunter has a very, very hard time dealing with one health minions. And that's exactly what he will produce. if the role will be Misha. I mean, a Huffer would be perfectly fine.
I think, yeah, just roll Huffer like every other Hunter player, yeah. Right?
Then he could buff it. That would be pretty convenient. I'm not sure whether I like what he just did, because, I mean, first of all, he broke the bow. Second of all, he used the kill command only for 3 damage. And third of all, he played the 2-1 into the 1-1. I mean, it looks very weird.
Yeah, he would have, I think, liked another 2 or 3 minutes to sit there and really analyze exactly, you know, how do I use this 5 mana here in a non-horrible way? But
right,
the pressure you feel against Zoo is so great that sometimes you just have to put something on the board as well.
It's true. I mean, he just wanted to release the pressure a little bit. Maybe he didn't want to gamble on Animal Companion. I mean, all very, very reasonable thoughts.
Definitely. But now we are in this position where the Animal Companion's got to be played anyway, because you've got nothing else to do. So you might as well play it last and try and roll a Huffer. And
yeah,
if you do, you're back in. You take your 1-3 to get back in the game without being inefficient.
It's true. But to be fair, it was a very crappy situation anyway. So it was probably rather to choose between the one bad player or the other bad player.
And Ness here, I mean, the Doomguard was going to be good, but drawing this Imp Gang boss has made his board so solid now, so hard. There is the Huffer.
Ah, it would have been Huffer. Oh, damn.
Obviously, yeah.
Who could have known?
Exactly how it works.
But yeah, if it would have been the Huffer roll, it would have been way better, but of course you don't know that beforehand.
And the other two would have been pretty bad, so.
Yeah.
Right.
Whereas Leo would have not been that bad, right? I mean, the peddler would have traded into the Leog, leaving 3 health behind, and then you could have boated or kill commanded it.
Sure.
So it would have not been disastrous.
Yeah, if you can make a case for one of the other two being pretty good, then it's, I think you go for 2 and 3 there for sure.
Yeah, I think it's okay. I guess in 2 cases you would have lost a little bit. In 1 case you would have gained a tremendous amount. So.
And just to emphasize, we've been talking about this play for 4 minutes. He had 70 seconds.
Yeah, it's true. It's true. Yeah, definitely.
So, Ness not even messing around here, just hitting in the face, getting rid of the Huffer.
Yep.
And this is exactly the situation you predicted. We're out of cards. We've got 2 Call of the Wilds. We've got nothing to do on turn 6,
right,
really. And then turn 7 is going to just be
empty, yeah.
Probably empty and probably just dying.
Yeah, not much to say to it now, because it's,
So, Feili trying to preserve his life, probably thinking whether the Argent Squire or just the hero power is the better choice. Like, do I want to reduce his chance to tap for more cards, or do I want to put down the Argent Squire and maybe draw something that buffs it to kill something? I mean, they're both pretty moot. He looks pretty doomed here, but weighing his options.
Yeah, I think you just Houndmaster and maybe just hero power. Maybe you play both. It really doesn't matter that much in this position. I mean, it's really a little bit sad for Feili, because if he would have just gotten these 2 Call of the Wilds in any order, I mean, in any order,
but if
he would have just got them on the board, he would have won for sure. Zoo can never handle double Call of the Wild, but it's just too late.
But then people say this is one of the best cards in Hearthstone, the Call of the Wild, and I agree, but if it's in your hand and you can't play it,
sure,
it's not very good if you haven't got 8 mana. So that's why cards like this are never easily assessed. You've got to assess it in the context of everything else going on around the deck.
Right. The tap might have been also, I mean, he could have just played the giant, right?
Mm-hmm.
And he opted in for the tap. Did you like it?
I did just play the giant against Hunter when I've got the board and it's turn 7 coming up. I just want to go, okay, I don't want to lose any more life. I just want to put my big things. I guess he's seen, you know, there's Hunter's marks and stuff in there. Maybe he just wanted the extra card to go with his giant.
Oh, but it didn't matter. He could tap and play the giant anyways, so never mind.
Okay, so Feili concedes, and Ness gets through to yet another top 8, defending his title.
That's pretty sick.
Pretty sick, man. So, what do you think of the match there?
Yeah, I mean, being the defender of the title, I guess Ness had a lot to lose, so I'm not surprised that he really gave it all and also program. I also saw him practicing kind of a lot the last week on the ladder. I always saw him online trying hard. I guess he just thought also a lot about this event, didn't want to fail in the very moments, in the moments of the heat, because there was also some controversy, let's say last Insomnia, where he was very nervous and did the one or the other small misstep and was being criticized a little bit. And I guess he did the right thing. He said, okay, yeah, maybe I have been a little bit nervous this time because it was my first major event. I put the hours together, I practice a lot, and this time I will show that I'm not a random winner of this title, but that I can prove myself and that I can also advance.
They have come out yet another strong group, so yes, starting to show the naysayers I can do this.
Right, exactly.
I agree completely as well, mainly because Ness is my teammate, so it's
he's
like,
biased.
I am very biased, but no, I think overall, like, Ness actually played quite solid throughout the whole series, like, much, you know, you could go back, like, early this year, and like the difference is actually noticeable. So, you know, exactly what you were saying, Live Coach. But really, yeah, cool series overall. Ness has a chance of actually being a two-time True Silver champion, which is a huge deal. If you can make that as a player, winning back-to-back majors, that's like very, very impressive.
Oh, yeah.